Welcome. This is Thursday, the 24th of April. This is Talk God Live with me, Doug Harris. Glad you've joined us. I hope you're ready to get involved with the program. The email is open, live@talkgod.com. In a little while, we'll be opening the phone lines as well. So please be ready to share with us, to tell us your stories. Maybe you're going to disagree with my guest today. Fine, just come on in. As long as you're nice about it, come along and share. We can have a great discussion. I'm really glad to welcome back Peter Price. Peter, welcome. Peter, if you remember, was the fastest milkman in the West until you lost your bottle. I think that was as a saying goes. But Peter is pastor of the Craven Arms Evangelical Church on the sort of the Welsh borders, isn't it? Up by Ludlow somewhere.
That's right. It's the Welsh Marches.
Yeah, right. Whatever that means. It's right out in the wilds. I know it takes me forever when I'm going to get there. Really appreciate you coming,
Thank you for
Peter.
Inviting me, Doug. Good to be here again.
Great. Peter was with us in January. We never got halfway through the program, and so we've invited him back. And I suspect, as we've talked it through today, we're not even going to get through all we want to today. Peter used to be a Jehovah's Witness. I'm going to get him to bring us up to date a little bit in just a minute from the last program, and then we're going to build on that. But maybe you're listening, and I say in a while we're going to open the phone lines, the email's already open. Maybe you are a Jehovah's Witness and you've got a different point of view. Please ring up and talk to us. Maybe you've been thinking about it or have got family that are involved. Please ring up and talk to us, and we're glad to share with you. We want to hear your point of view. We'll try and answer every question. We're not walking encyclopedias, but we'll do our very best for you. And anything that we can't answer, we will certainly seek to find an answer for and get back to you. So sit back, relax, put your feet up. I trust you've already got your cup of coffee or your after-dinner cup of tea. And so now enjoy this program with us. So, Peter, just give us that little bit of recap of how you got into Jehovah's Witnesses and how you got out of Jehovah's Witnesses and a little bit of what you're doing today as well. So
thank
bring
you,
us
Doug.
Up to date.
Yes, just a recap really on where we were a couple of months ago. I was brought up as a Jehovah's Witness from quite young, from 7 or 8 years old. Come 1956, I was actually baptized as a Jehovah's Witness, age 10, and from then on started going from door to door, regularly with my mother, grandma and friends in the congregation in South Devon that we were attached to. Number of years went on. I felt as I left school and took up a bit of secular work that ultimately I really wanted to become what the witnesses call a regular pioneer. Now that's somebody who commits themselves to going 100 hours at least a month, going from door to door.
So 100 hours actually out in the street taking Bible studies or knocking on doors.
That's right. Yeah, doing that whole ministry.
That's
really.
That's quite a commitment, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. So it was a minimum of sort of 25 hours every week.
Right.
And I would do that from when I was about 18 or 19. And I did that for a number of years, met Marilyn, my wife, when she was quite young. She was also a regular pioneer in the Midlands, which is where I finished up. And we worked together for quite a while. We got married in 69 and then went on as full-time evangelists to Scotland, to Fraserburgh and Peterhead in the northeast corner of Scotland, which was a challenge. We'd never seen horizontal rain before. So that was fun. And we were there for 2 or 3 years until our first child, Matthew, came along. And then we moved down back to Devon in the early 1970s. And we continued there in the local congregation in South Devon, where I became one of the elders in the congregation, eventually what they call the presiding overseer, which was like the pastor, really,
right,
for the local congregation.
And so you had responsibility for all the people, for disfellowshippings, and for all that came down to your responsibility.
Yes, yes. They're voluntary positions, so they're not a paid position.
Right.
So
I
was working in the secular world to support myself, but carrying out these responsibilities in the congregation. And that was fine until sort of the mid-1970s, when the Jehovah's Witnesses had made a big play on the end of the world coming around 1975. And when patently that didn't happen, a lot of questions then started to resolve themselves in my mind, and to find out really whether the Witnesses were, if they were wrong on this, they might well be wrong on other issues.
Yeah.
And that was a very difficult time, a time of spiritual searching. I put the Watchtower publications on one side and looked at God's Word on its own.
And that was the first time you'd done it, because that isn't recommended, is it? In fact, it's frowned upon if you do that, because you should really only read the Bible with Watchtower publications.
That's right. And yes, that was a very difficult time, and something that was not encouraged, really, that if you had any questions, the plan would be that you would check first the Watchtower publications rather than any outside sources.
Right.
So this was, and really I kept this to myself, what I was doing. I don't think I even then really at that point confided in my wife. So that led really for the next year or so, and to my horror, I found that much of what I'd been taught actually was unscriptural.
Wow.
And really then that was a crisis of faith.
Yeah.
It was a very critical time, and ultimately I felt I had no option but to leave the Witnesses, because there is no place really in the organization for dissent or doubt.
Right.
You've either got to be in 100%, or if you have doubts that can't be resolved, you need to leave, which is what I did.
Right.
Very painful, very difficult, with family ties and so forth. So in the late 1970s, early 80s, I left. That left, and Marilyn followed a couple of years later. That led really to a time of, as we said last time, 9 or 10 years in a spiritual wilderness, where we not only we rejected the Witnesses of having the truth, but didn't know where else to find it.
Right.
So it was not until the late 80s, early 90s, when we became Christians. My son led us to the Lord,
right,
and we became Christians, and we now pastor 10 years on after, 10 years on after that. We pastor a church now in Craven Arms in Shropshire.
Right. So quite a journey. I mean, that's been summed up. Anybody that wants to catch up on that, it certainly is on YouTube, and there's a link to that from our site, reachouttrust.org. If you go onto the main website there, you'll find a link to that. And so you can catch up in more detail. We spent a couple of hours on that last time, keeping up to date. So now you've come out. Now, if you can you sum up, Peter, the difference now? So you almost had a, like the children of Israel, you came out of Egypt, you had a wilderness experience, and then you went into the promised land. Can you sort of sum up the difference that you felt between being in the Witnesses and now becoming a Christian? What were some of the differences that you really hit upon and saw as you started your new Christian life?
I think there's several. I think one of the big shocks to us was we were attached to a Baptist church in South Devon, and I should be very grateful for the help they gave us. But the Witnesses had given us to understand that all the churches, none of them believe the Bible, they don't teach God's Word, and only the Witnesses do. To our amazement and joy, we found that actually the church that we were going to did teach the Bible,
right,
and did teach God's Word. I think one of the key areas of difference was that for the first time we found a body of people whereby not everybody had to think and believe exactly the same. And I think there's a sense that within some of these organizations, like the Witnesses and others, this sense that everybody thinks the same and believes the same, they confuse that with the biblical issue of unity.
Right.
It actually is more an issue of uniformity.
In other words, it's a man-made thing rather than the unity that we read of in Ephesians is the unity of the Spirit, isn't it?
That's right.
Rather than a whole set of rules and regulations that says this is what your belief or else, basically.
Yeah, just so.
Yeah.
So when we came into the church, and we found that since, that although the majority of Christians agree on the fundamental principles of Scripture, and that's great, but within that, there's a whole range of differences of opinion. And initially, I found that quite quite threatening, quite daunting, really. I thought, no, everybody should think exactly the same, because that's the way we were brought up.
Yeah.
But actually, in time, I found it was really refreshing, a freedom to actually question, debate, discuss, and sometimes to disagree within that framework of overall unity, but differences on detail.
Right.
So that was great.
Yes. So in other words, the restraints had been taken off, but that freedom, as freedom can so often be, actually brings a responsibility, doesn't it? Because you can't just go in the end where you like, because although no man was saying to you, you've got to believe this in its very straitjacket way, you still only have the scriptures which you need to get into to see what you should be believing. So there is responsibility with that freedom.
Yes. I think you've touched on a very important issue there, Doug. To my knowledge, no person has ever become a Jehovah's Witness from reading solely the Bible.
Right.
It would only be with the Bible and their publications. Whereas there are countless instances of men and women who have come to faith in Christ Jesus purely from reading the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, it says an awful lot.
Right. Let's open up the phone lines. You can see where we're going. We're going to develop some of the things that Jehovah's Witnesses do, and we're going to ask the question, is it biblical? Already we're beginning to look at some of these things. You can hear what Peter is saying. If you disagree, yeah, fine. Please get on the phone, put your point of view in a constructive way, and we can chat about it. If you've got problems with people in your family who are Jehovah's Witnesses and you want some advice, or neighbours or whatever, great, please come on to us. The phone number is 0208 972 1408, 0208 972 1408. The email is live@talkgod.com. Really want to hear from you. As I always say, I'm happy to talk with my guests for 2 hours, but you know, come on in, put your point of view, ask your questions, share your thoughts, because that makes it far more interactive, and that's what we want from these programs. So you really had to start looking, although you had a biblical knowledge. In other words, with the Witnesses, they do have their New World Translation, and however else, whatever else they may do, you're encouraged to read the Bible. But now you had to read the Bible in a totally different way. Did you have to change the way you did that, the way you thought about it? Was that original teaching a help to you or a hindrance to you?
I think this... The help, let's look at the positive side first. I think what the Witnesses helped us to do was to actually physically to be able to study the Bible, to use concordances, to use cross-references, to use Bible dictionaries. And that was enormously helpful, and I found that very helpful since. So there was a discipline. That discipline of actually studying the Bible was very, very helpful. However, what became very interesting is that we started to read passages in John where Jesus says that the Spirit of truth will lead you into all truth. So for the first time, we became dependent on hearing God's voice and his Spirit rather than some extraneous publication.
And that must have been difficult for you, because you didn't even before believe in the Holy Spirit
That's
as
right.
a person, did you?
That's right.
So,
That's right.
Boy, you had so much new stuff to learn.
Yeah, yeah. That's right.
Peter, we got our first caller, so let's go there. We've got Kathleen from Preston. Good afternoon, Kathleen.
Good afternoon.
How are you doing?
Okay, thank you. I've been waiting all week for this programme. As soon as you said a Jehovah's Witness was on.
Right.
Next week, I wrote it down so I wouldn't forget.
Great to have you with us.
I just hope a neighbour who I love dearly doesn't knock on my door now, because she is a Jehovah's Witness.
Right.
And since the 80s, I've had Jehovah's Witnesses calling on... Well, that was the first time Jehovah's Witnesses called on me. And I must thank them for me reading the Bible, because I was a Christian. I was baptised, confirmed in the Church of England. And my husband read the Bible, but I didn't read the Bible. And they came and they got me reading. But as we went along with these lessons, I was seeing things that they wasn't seeing, because I was reading from the King James.
Right.
And they had their Bible.
New World Translation, yes.
So, anyway, in the end, I have to say, I'm sorry, come with your Bible, but not with your literature.
Right.
I said, and they said, oh, this is only aid. This is only an aid to it. I said, but the Holy Spirit is my aid.
Amen, yeah.
So, that was that. Then I went into the world a bit. Well, no, I went to Evangelical Church, and then that's where I got born again. And
right.
Then we moved down to over to Scotland, the Isle of Lewis, actually.
Wow.
And it's all different again there, because there's three Presbyterian, there's three church, they don't do nothing on a Sunday. You're just with a family, we're just out to going to church. Then we moved to Southport.
And slightly different.
And went back to Church of England. And
right.
So I've been kind of in a church, out of a church. Anyway, Jehovah's Witnesses came again while I'm in Preston.
Right.
And I had them coming again. But really, my was to try and preach to them, but without them knowing. Anyway, in the end, I had to, say no. Like, I don't believe. Because it's like this 144,000.
Yep.
And that Jesus didn't get authority till 1914.
That's right.
And all this, I thought, I said, well, if it's only for the 144,000, I might as well not read it. Because, saying I'm not one of them 144,000.
Yeah, that's right.
And then the paradise earth, I just couldn't get my head around that.
Right. So many things, aren't there, which are so different.
Yes.
To what we understand in evangelical Christianity, yes.
So in the end, again, they had to go. Then I went to a Methodist church, and I was involved in that for 2 years. But we had a Bible study, and then the devil came into it. I said, I don't like this talk about the devil here and the devil there. And,
right.
I wasn't saying there was no devil in a way, because there is evil in the world, and... Anyway, I stopped going there. It all kind of fizzled out. So I'm like in no man's land now. Well, the Revelation TV and Genesis TV it's brilliant. So, but how can I witness now?
How can you witness?
Jehovah's Witness across the road, because I do love a dearly.
Right, okay. Let's ask Peter that specific question.
Yeah.
What can Kathleen say? Here are these people coming. Obviously, she can disagree with all the things, but what positively can she say to the people that come?
Hello, Kathleen.
Hello.
It's good to talk to you, Kathleen.
Oh, lovely.
Just to recap, Kathleen, your neighbour, this is somebody that...
We're talking general to people
generally.
Now. Generally, to people, yeah.
Fine. I think the key issue here, Kathleen, is to show love and care for them.
I ask her in and I do show that, yeah.
That's great. I think we touched on this a couple of months ago. There's a sense, there's two ways you can approach it. One is you can bring out the Bible, of course, that's excellent to do.
Yes.
But often, all that happens is you engage, as Doug described a couple of months ago, a sort of spiritual table tennis. Mm. You lob one scripture over and they lob another,
another
one back. So there's that approach. But I think possibly the more fundamental approach, which might suit you, is to share your story.
Yeah.
You were saying earlier on that you've received the Lord, you've become born again, and we praise God for that.
Thank you.
That situation is not what the majority of Jehovah's Witnesses can experience. Okay. They do not experience that inner sense of the Holy Spirit being with them. If you can do nothing else, Kathy, to share your testimony, you could be very kind to them and say, look, thank you for coming and talking to me this morning. I won't take your literature if you don't mind, but I would just like to share with you something that's happened to me and the difference that Jesus Christ has made in my life.
Right.
And when that is so powerful, because a witness will not have that experience. It'll be unique to you.
Right.
And that would be so powerful, Kathleen.
Amen.
Yeah. I will do that then.
It is, Kathleen, it is, as Peter was saying, that sharing the love. And even when, you know, even when you want to disagree, you don't have to say you're wrong.
Yes.
You can say, well, I actually see it in a slightly different way.
Yeah.
And all the time you're being positive towards them. So it's not negatively you're wrong. And it's not even saying, hey, I'm right. But it's communicating that relationship that you have.
Yes.
Kathleen, we've got another caller. So
yes, thank you very much.
If we can be of further help, reachouttrust.org. The details will be up on the screen at some point. Do come onto our website. And if we can help you further in any way, please make sure you make contact. Email me after the show and I'll gladly talk with you some more.
Okay, yeah. Thank you very much.
Bless you, Kathleen.
Yeah, God bless,
okay.
Kathleen.
Bye
God
now.
Bless.
Bye. Bye. Matilda.
Hello there.
Hello, sorry to keep you waiting.
Hi, yes, so the last caller, you've actually just answered a question of mine, which is I've been talking about Jehovah's Witnesses for quite a few years, and I've managed to build a very good relationship with them.
Right.
And I know a bit of Hebrew and Greek, so I put them through the gospel with the, you know, the Logos, in the beginning God was the word of God was. The word was God, and even though I took them through all of that, and I took them through all, you know, the Ego Amy saying, you know,
yes.
Saying, I am who I am.
Right.
They still didn't, you know, they couldn't answer me properly, but they didn't want it. But I just want to know what.
Right.
I could say that would break through all those arguments.
I'll just share how I would normally do it, and then Peter can come on as well. And the thing always to remember here, Matilda, is. Even if you do appear to be winning an argument, they may not agree with you, but you just carry on sowing that doubt, whatever they're saying. The way I deal with John 1 is obviously they translate it, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was a God.
Yeah.
I say, well, okay, that word there is theos, therefore yeah. It's God. It could be big G, it could be small g. How do we know? The context will tell us. And so I then say, well, let's look at the context. So we start John 1:1, in the beginning. Does that remind you of anywhere else?
Yeah.
Genesis 1:1.
Yeah.
Okay. So in the beginning, God, i.e. when the beginning began, God was there. Do you, Mr. Witness, do you think that that is a created God? No, no. Of course they don't. That's Jehovah God. Well, John 1:1 is exactly the same construction. In the beginning was the Word. When the beginning began, the Word, Jesus, was already there.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mr. Witness, that one cannot be created, can he?
Mm.
And then I go down to verse 3.
Yeah.
By the way, this is on our website, so you don't have to remember it all, but if you're recording it, you'll get it anyway. But then I go down to verse 3, and then it says that all things that ever came into being... came into being through Jesus.
Mm.
Well, if everything that has a beginning began through Jesus, Jesus couldn't be a beginning himself. He couldn't be created. And
wow.
So you see the context of John 1, verse 1, and John 1, verse 3, is an eternal being that cannot be a small g God.
Mm.
Now, they're not necessarily going to believe you on that, but you've made a very clear representation as to why that cannot be a God.
Mm.
But the important thing is however you share it, and I'll pass over to Peter now, but what you said about sharing all the I ams is great. Just leave it with them. Allow the Holy Spirit to touch them in their lives.
Mm.
Yeah.
Peter,
I found that the best way.
Yeah.
Hello, Matilda.
Hello.
Good to talk to you. Matilda, this is actually part, of course, a bigger issue. This whole issue of the witness's understanding of Jesus and his relationship to the Father. And as you know, Christians would understand Jesus to be God,
yeah.
God the Son.
Yeah.
What might be helpful is to take them in the whole of this conversation, just perhaps move away from John 1:1 and maybe direct them to John 8.
Uh-huh. And that's where I went next.
Sorry?
That's where I went next.
Okay. Right. John 8, and it's interesting picking it up from their own Bible, because in John 8, as you know, there's this conversation between Jesus and the religious leaders, and they're arguing about who's about parentage, really. And Jesus is saying, well, actually, you're from your father, the devil, and so forth. So it goes on. Then, in John 8:56, Jesus says, Abraham, your father, rejoiced greatly in the prospect of seeing my day, and he saw it and rejoiced. Therefore, the Jews said to him, you are not yet 50 years old, and still you have seen Abraham. Now here's the key verse, Matilda. Verse 58, Jesus said to them, most truly I say to you, before Abraham came into existence, I have been. Now that's what their New World Translation says. But if you use their interlinear, their own Greek and English interlinear, and go across the page, it says there, before Abraham was, I am. You could then ask, Mr. Witness, who is the I am? Now, the witnesses will understand that the only I am that they know about is Yahweh, Jehovah, that I am from the Old Testament. So here was Jesus saying, before Abraham was, not just I have been, which is a watered down version, really, but before Abraham was, I am. Yes. He's saying there, he is God. And maybe that will give them something to really think about. You may want to say, look, would you like to give that some thought? And maybe we can talk further. But at least it will give them something to think about, yeah. Matilda.
Yes. Yes. And can I just ask you one other question? I invited to the church with me. And because I went to church with them, I hope I did the right thing. But I went to church with them. And I saw how they worship. And then I said, well, will you come to my church?
Yeah.
Was that the right thing to do?
Yeah.
I disagree.
You have to be open before the Lord. Some people feel they can go. Some people feel they can't go. That's true. There is absolutely, if you are safe in Christ, if you know your security in Christ, there's no problem in you going there. You can be relaxed in the Lord and you can share Christ and you can show forth Christ. Totally up to you on that. Each one must walk before God as far as that's concerned. Yeah. Matilda, keep reaching out to them. Keep loving them. If you need more help, get onto our website at Reach Out Trust. We'll gladly help you further there. But we need to move on. We've got more callers. But if you want further help on that, email us after the program.
Oh, thank you very much.
Okay, bless you, Matilda.
Okay. Bless you there. Bye
now. Dave. Hi, Dave.
Evening, afternoon. I was going to say evening then, but it's still afternoon.
Nah, it's not yet. Come on. Don't waste the day away.
No, I said, someone said to me, don't give up your day job. I said, well, it's gone night now, so I have to, I said to them.
Right,
so,
come on. What can we do for you today?
Yeah, just saying, it's good to have a sense of humour. I think it helps you sometimes, because there's time to laugh. But yeah, what I was going to say, actually, you were talking about sharing your life with
yes.
Witnesses. Well, we've done that. We've told them our testimony, and we had them here this morning because they're outside, and it was a bit rainy. So my wife said to them, why don't you come in? You look a bit cold. Oh, are you sure? Yeah, come in. I even offered them a cup of tea, but they said I had one earlier, so they felt relaxed. And so after that, now I know things like 144,000 and the Trinity are areas that are. That you don't get on, but they do bring it up because they say in order for you to go further, you have to give up on this idea of the Trinity being one but three and three but one.
Right.
They say it. And what I said to them in a nice way, regarding John chapter 1, they said it goes to Greek or Hebrew. And I looked at the John translation of John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and I said, look, what are you using? I said, Greek like you're using. And he says, what's the word, not a word. Oh, are you sure? I wasn't trying to score points for them.
Right.
I'm just trying to say,
yeah.
It talks about in the scripture, give an answer with understanding. Anyway, so I did that. And about the 144,000, I posted them a bit of a challenge. I said, okay, if you say the 144,000 are the only ones in heaven, isn't it going to be quite empty?
Yeah.
And I said to them, if you could show me a verse, I didn't say I believe. I said, if you show me a verse, I'll be interested to see where it says only 144,000 are going to heaven.
Right.
Please. I asked them nicely. And we shared what we believed. I said to them, I do believe there are 144,000, but if you're saying it's men and women, how comes in John 14? I know a lot of Revelation is future, and you've got to be careful interpretation in today's.
Yeah, Revelation 7, yeah, and 14, yeah.
And I said to them, it said they've kept themselves from women. Now, is it literal 14, 144 verses on, or symbolic? And if it's literal, well, you can't literalise part of them and all of them. It's either, it's up to you whether you believe it.
That's right.
I basically shared that to them. I just thought I'd share it. It's quite...
No, that's right. I find this whole area, I often, well, they don't talk to me that much these days, but when I still have opportunity, I often deal with 144,000 and that. Was that sort of thing, Peter, something that became a problem to you, looking at this 144,000, that these were the elite and the rest of us have a different salvation? Was that something that became a problem to you?
Yes, it was, because... It's good to talk to you, David. Thank you for phoning, and well done for inviting them in, actually. That was really kind and generous and hospitable. Yes, this whole issue of 144,000 was a problem, because as I started to read the New Testament, it just strikes me that every passage that you read about people who are born again and are going to heaven, it is the common experience and should be the common experience of every person who claims to follow Christ. Not a tiny minority. Every person who follows Christ should be born again and would expect to live with Christ in heaven. So, yes, it was a problem in when I was sort of in the searching times. But when we came to Christ, of course, to know that the truth about this was very, very releasing.
One of the things, Dave, that I would also do in dealing with this 144,000 is, because what you end up with the Watchtower understanding is you have 144,000 in heaven, you have this void in the middle, as it were, and the great crowd on earth, and never the two shall meet. But when you get to Revelation... And chapter 21, you actually find heaven and earth is all gloriously rolled into one again. And there's one kingdom with one king. And that's exactly what John 10 says, when that's where they get this phrase, the other sheep from. Other sheep I have not of this fold. But even there it says that the two, the other sheep and the sheep, will become one flock with one shepherd. And so I always share with them that in the end, the biblical picture is not of two distinct kingdoms, but of one kingdom with one king and one way into that kingdom.
Yeah. Can I just... you're still there, David?
Yeah, sorry, I was just listening.
He's just trying to mull that through, yeah.
Just something I'll just add to that Doug's mentioned, Dave, was that, as Doug has said, the witness's concept of salvation is that there are these two groups, what they call the little flock, 144,000, and the great crowd, the little flock going to heaven, great crowd going to live on the earth. A scripture which might be helpful in sharing, and it says this in their own Bible, and when I came out of the witnesses, I was absolutely shattered to read in Revelation 19 and verse 1, from their own Bible, it says, "After these things, I heard what was a loud voice of a great crowd in heaven." They said, "Praise Jah, you people. Salvation and glory and the power belong to our God." I'd read that scripture many, many times, but it had never struck me. The great crowd, yes, there is a great crowd, but they're in heaven.
Yeah. So, Dave, the thing, obviously, that we're sharing is to sow doubt, put that question mark over what they say. We're not out just to try and convince them, but we're out to show them that there's another way, and we're out to show them that, in one sense, there is a better way than the one they have. And it all comes around that relationship with Jesus. We all have and all need that same relationship with Jesus. There are not two levels to it.
Doug, I was just saying, I'd like to share a little funny story. It's not very long.
Can we just be quick? I've got another call, but be quick, yeah.
What it was, it's back in the days when Moody was preaching. So, you know, D.L. Moody, a famous evangelist.
Yes, yeah, good old Moody. Yeah,
apparently, there was a guy at a church, and he had holes in his shoes. I'll just try to say. And even though he had lots of, he wasn't very well off, he used to like saying, "Hallelujah, praise the Lord."
Yeah.
And so he kept saying that. So the elders of the church said, "Look, we got D.L. Moody coming, could you just keep, you know, just tone it down for a little while?" And he says, "I will, I'll find it, but I'll tell you what, we see you need new shoes. So every time D.L. Moody speaks and he really gets you in an encouragement, just think new shoes. So D.L. Moody came and he started to speak on heaven. He said, it's a wonderful place. And he thought, oh, I've got to keep quiet, and new shoes. But eventually he got so enthusiastic, said, shoes or no shoes, hallelujah anyway.
Yeah.
And so that's his reaction. If that's what his reaction is now, how much should our reaction be when we share, even though we should share the truth, but share it in such a way to show enthusiasm. And
amen.
Energy. God bless you, mate.
Be enthusiastic, be loving, keep going, Dave. Yeah. Bless
well done,
you.
David.
Thanks
bless
for
you,
the
both.
Call.
Bye.
Okay.
Thank you, David.
Joyce from Newcastle.
Hello, Dirk. Hello.
Joyce, what are you doing phoning so early in the programme?
I'm usually the last one.
I know. Come on.
I'm going to be with 140.
You want to get in quick, I know. What can we
Hello,
do for you
Peter.
Today?
Hello, Joyce.
Well, actually, I've been having Jehovah's Witnesses coming to my house for the last 2 years, two gentlemen. I haven't seen them for a few weeks. So there was two lady Jehovah. Do you know when they gather on the corners? Are they praying or are they deciding which doors they're going to?
I think they're just wasting a bit of time to save knocking on the doors.
Well, these two ladies passed my door, you see.
Right.
And they went to the door after while I was going out, and I caught them up the street. And I said, why did you not knock at my door? she says, what number? I said, oh, 47. She says, oh, yes, we've got you down as elder. So do they have, I don't know, I think I must be getting two elders from the church.
So that probably they will put that, in other words, not everybody should call at the door, only certain people should call. You're causing problems, Joyce. Do they mark they have these little forms that they obviously all fill in. Do they mark them if people are difficult and people are harder? Give us the inside track here.
Well, I usually
let Peter answer. He'll just share that. We'll come back to you, Joyce. Yeah.
Joyce, just to recap, what did you say that they got on there, the reason they didn't call?
Elder.
Elder.
They had
okay.
Elder.
Yeah, so they would want only an elder to call on you. Okay. Yeah, I would think they would still keep the same sort of records as we kept when we were going from door to door. Our favourite one was DNC, which was Do Not Call. And generally, that was either, we put that down if they were particularly abusive, we would put down Do Not Call, but more often that if somebody really knew their Bible and really challenged us, Joyce, then we would put down Do Not Call.
I've got about 8 Bibles lying around, so wherever they went, there was a Bible.
Found a Bible.
Actually, the one thing I did stick to, and you mentioned it before, was I am. Mm. And one day I'm going to go through all the New Testament and see how many times Jesus actually said, I am.
Yeah. Start with John's Gospel, because you'll find some great ones in there.
I have started.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, I used to invite them in, a cup of tea. They'll probably come back. He's probably on holiday or something now.
The elders might well, because of that, the elders might well come back. But when I first got into this ministry, they used to call, and then they got fed up with me and found out who I was, so they didn't call at my door. But what I used to do if I saw them down the street, and still do if I'm in when they're around, is I will go out to sort of mend the garden gate or clean the car or something, and as they go past, say, hi, how you doing? And they get so embarrassed that normally they will stop and talk to you. So, you know, don't worry about it. You know, if you see them coming along, get out there and chat to them.
Some people worry about them coming and some people worry about
I know.
Them not coming.
Aren't we a fickle lot?
Anyway, God bless you and thank you very much.
Joyce.
Yeah, bless you, Joyce. Bless you, okay, Joyce. Thanks. Keep watching. Keep calling. Glad to hear from you.
Doug. Can we just come back briefly on John 1?
Yes, please do.
If you tackle the witnesses on John 1, and they will take you back to the Greek, and they will say that you might challenge them and say, look, the original Greek doesn't say, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was a God. their argument is that, all right, there's no indefinite article.
That's right,
there.
Yeah.
But if John had meant to say that Jesus was God, the word was God the Father, he was God the Son, then it would have the definite article in front of it. So the lack of the definite article is saying that actually Jesus was a minor God. I think an answer to that might be helpful in taking them back to John 20, when Jesus is talking to Thomas,
yeah,
and John 20:28. When they have this conversation, Thomas wants to put his hands and fingers in the holes of Jesus' hands and feet. When he does so, he then says, "My Lord and my God." The Greek here is literally "the God" That's of right. me and the Lord of me. Theos and Hokilios.
Yeah.
The God, the Lord. So what Thomas was saying was acknowledging that this was the God.
And of course, in the New World Translation, in John 20:28, they have to put, because of that, a big G for God.
Yes, they do.
So even in their Bible, Thomas calls Jesus God. Big G.
That's right.
And of course, then they have to start finding out all sorts of reasons why he didn't mean what he said, but we won't go into that just at the moment. Yeah.
Again, it might, rather than presenting it contentiously, it might just be a matter of saying, look, would you like to give some thought?
Absolutely. Sow the doubt. Put the question mark in. Margaret, are you still there, Margaret?
Yes, I am.
Hi, hiya. How you
Hello,
doing?
Hello, hiya.
What can we do for you?
Well, what that man next to you was just saying, that's exactly what I rang up to say.
Right.
That when Thomas, isn't it strange how God works? I mean, I'm here and I'm listening and it's exactly what I rang up to say.
Terrific.
Yes, I mean, yes, Thomas did do that and he did say, "My Lord and my God." And, you know, Jesus didn't correct him.
That's the important thing, isn't it, as well, Margaret?
Yeah. Oh, you know, and Jesus corrected them time and time again.
And even more than not correct him, he actually goes on and says, "Blessed are all those that believe what Thomas believed, haven't seen me, but believe what Thomas believed."
Yeah.
And so he's very positive over, we should have the same belief as Thomas had.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
Those verses are terrific, aren't they?
Well, the Bible also says that Jesus has the name above all names in the heavens.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah. It also says that he's been given all authority in the heavens and on the earth.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, that's the Almighty God.
Amen.
Of course it is.
That's a, Joyce, sorry, Margaret, that's an excellent point you've made there, because that scripture, I think it's in Acts, isn't it, where it says that Jesus is given the name above all names.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's just good to ask the witnesses, what, Mr. Witness, would you understand to be the name above all names?
Oh, yes, well, I did have a study with the witnesses.
You did?
I did take a study with the witnesses. And there were so many things that I just could not accept, that I backed out.
Right.
I could not...
But you've obviously become a Christian since then?
Yes, I am.
Yeah,
yes,
great.
I know Jesus, and Jesus knows me.
Excellent.
Amen. And my sheep know his voice, yeah.
Yes, it's not enough to just know Jesus. You have to know that he knows you.
Amen.
Yes, Margaret. Amen. Absolutely.
Great, Margaret. Bless you. Thanks for calling and for underlining that for us.
Bless you too. Thank you.
Okay,
thank you, Margaret.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Peter, one of the things that strikes me is, and I think it might help viewers that see Jehovah's Witnesses around the street, is to understand why are they coming to the doors. Are they coming, and maybe we can't totally generalize, but if you want to pontificate a little bit on it, are they coming because of a love for Jehovah, or are they coming because of a fear that if they're not doing it and Armageddon comes, they've had it? In other words, is it love of relationship or fear of something that's going to happen?
Yeah, I think it's a good question to ask. And obviously, I can't answer for
everybody.
Witnesses. I can only answer for myself.
Yes.
I can genuinely say that for many years, it was love of God. I genuinely wanted to do God's will. And I think, to be absolutely fair, that's the experience of the majority of witnesses I think it would be very unfair to say that anything else. It's generally is a motivation of love. But I think the fear aspect comes into it from time to time. And the organisation tend to feed that. Yeah. I remember one instance they gave us, it was in one of their Watchtower magazines, they were saying, they were giving this story about this gang warfare that had broken out in some city or other. And there was crossfire going on. And this Jehovah's Witness, who could have been, and they would say should have been, going out from door to door, was actually at home instead of being out in the doors. And actually, they were tragically caught in the crossfire and killed. Now, the underlying message from that was, if they had been going out from door to door, they wouldn't have been in that position. Mm. Now, the implication for that was that really, we should be out going from door to door. So it wasn't always explicit, that fear, but there was an implicit feeding of fear and insecurity. And we never felt that, well, I never felt, I can't speak for others, so I must be careful. I never felt, Doug, that I'd ever done enough. Right. If that makes sense.
Yes, it does.
I was always unsure, have I been to enough meetings? Have I been out from door to door enough?
Right.
Or should I have done more? And really, they say, well, you probably won't know until Judgment Day.
And then it might be too late.
It might be a bit late by then.
Because it is, isn't it? I mean, this is the teaching of the witnesses. Number one, that Armageddon's going to come around. They used to put dates to that, so 1914, 18, 25, 31, etc.
Yeah.
After 75, and that was the last big date that they put upon it, although they did sort of toy with 2000, but then a lot of people toyed with 2000. But after that, they've said, we've quit fixing dates, and they've actually came out publicly and said, we're not fixing dates anymore. But at the same time, they're saying, we're deep into the last days and any day now, and etc. And isn't it true that unless you're an active, loyal Jehovah's Witness on that day that Armageddon, God's wrath, is poured out, you've had it. Therefore, doesn't that, saying that and then saying Armageddon could come tomorrow, don't those two things come together in your mind to say, yeah, I've got to do it. But as you say, you never know you've done enough. No, so what a terrible state you must be in.
It is. And I think this went back to when we were deciding whether to go into full-time evangelism or not as a regular pioneer. There was huge pressure upon myself and others saying, well, look, if you're able-bodied enough, then you should be out there. And that put enormous pressure, not just upon young people, but old people as well, older folk who are really struggling perhaps with their health, saying, look, you really should be out there doing more. Mm. And it's a great shame, really, because the vast majority of witnesses really were doing all that they could and were really giving it their all. And I think, I must say this, from the best of motives.
Yes.
From the best of motives.
So you've got the motive, and I think we do want to underline that most people are really genuine. And yet in the background, there's this feeling, I can't stop anyway. So even though they're doing it, they also feel it because of God's wrath.
Yes.
Not because of his love, because of his wrath.
That's right. I did have this picture. I'm not saying that the witnesses gave me this picture, but when I was a witness, I did have this sort of mental picture of God up there with a massive control board in front of him, and right in the middle was a large red button marked Smite. Yeah. So there was this Smite button that if Peter Price got out of line, bang.
That's it,
And tragic, that really is a pressure to live with.
The Bible doesn't want us to God's judgment is there, but for his people, he wants us to know that relationship with him.
That's right. And I think for one of the most liberating scriptures was 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love. Perfect love throws fear outside.
Yeah. Amen. Gordon. Hi, Gordon. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Gordon. How you doing?
Okay, fine. How are you?
I'm doing fine, mate.
Good. Still got the waistcoat.
Still got the waistcoat. I'm going to the disco afterwards, yes. Can you imagine me on the disco dance floor? No, don't go there. Don't go there. What can we do for you? Are you going to share something with us, Gordon?
Well, as you know, I was a witness for 30 years.
Right.
1971 to 2001. And I thought I might as well put my bit in.
Please do.
You've just been talking about the fear factor with JWs. Yes, I can really imagine that. Remember all that with that. If you didn't do enough hours, didn't go to the meetings, etc., that you would be spoken to by the elders, and that it would be hinted that you wouldn't get through Armageddon, etc. You know, but it's the pressure that's put on JWs to do all this. I mean, I know from my own experience that, you know, particularly, you know, if you're a male, you're supposed to be reaching out and for a better position and so forth. And the pressure is always there, put on, you know, that that you should be doing better.
Yeah.
And, you know, even the latest watchtowers and that, you know, again, emphasizing do more in the ministry. And as Peter said, you know, there is no allowance made for those who are maybe elderly or sick or anything. I can recall many an elderly sister worried because she couldn't get out, you know, on the field service to do anything.
What's Gordon, from now, obviously, you've come to know Christ since then. What's your message to such people? So, you know, maybe there are Jehovah's Witnesses there and they wouldn't say it to the likes of you and me, how they feel, but they feel like it. What's your message to them these days?
You mean those who are probably having
those
doubts?
That have got doubts, that feel this pressure that you were just talking about.
That's their main problem, really, is that within the witness community, you can't talk to anyone and say you have doubts or that you don't think that the watchtower is right on something.
Yeah.
Because you're looked upon then as... you're apostate. You're speaking against God's organization. You know, you are going against Jehovah God.
Yeah.
And immediately they would step back from you, and you would be isolated, basically, or marked, as they would say, in such a way that, you know, so the only people you can go to are those on the outside, like Reach Out Trust, if they really need to find answers.
Yeah,
but it's again. It comes back to this fear thing,
right?
That, you know, if they question or doubt, that they're going to lose friends and family, like I have, you know.
Yeah, I think you've made such an important point there, Gordon. And I just want to pick up on that, actually. You mentioned the work of Reach Out Trust. I'm not just saying this because Doug is here, because I would say it to all and sundry. One of the important things that needs to happen when somebody comes out of the witnesses or any cult or sect is you almost need something in the way of exit counselling to help you deal with all the baggage and stuff that you've accumulated around you. And I would say to anyone, if you're needing help in that area, Doug and his ministry there with his colleague Derek is one of the best people to help. And Doug was... absolutely fundamentally important when Marilyn and I came out of the witnesses and we came to faith. They would Reach Out Trust and all the resources they brought to us, they were so helpful to us, Gordon. We don't know whether we would have made it without them. I have to say that.
Yes, the same with me, really, because when I stopped attending meetings, I hadn't actually disassociated by then. I just stopped meetings. I realized I really needed someone to guide me where I was going. I'd left the going to meetings, but I hadn't left God.
That's right.
I always say I left an organization. Right. I didn't leave God.
Amen.
And that I realized that I needed to find someone to help me, guide me. And of course, I'd read Doug's book, Awake to the Watchtower, as it was back then.
Yeah.
And I contacted him, and he put me in touch with a man, Vince McCann, and who's helped me tremendously over years.
That's right.
And guided me down the right way, and eventually I became a Christian.
Yeah.
But as Pete said, you know, so many witnesses who do have these doubts but think they're the only ones that there's no one out there for them,
right.
And that there's no one they can go to.
That's right.
Yeah.
And yet you can come to peace, can't you, in a relationship with Christ, not with an organization, but in that relationship with the person of Jesus Christ.
Oh, yes.
And I think, Gordon, if I can just say this to you, looking at you said you were in the witnesses from 71 to 2001.
Yeah.
That's 30 years.
Yeah.
Very similar sort of time to we were in.
Yeah.
And don't you find that when you've been in for so long and you've built up friendships, you've built up family connections, it becomes, every year that goes by, becomes harder to make the break.
Yes.
Mm.
Yeah.
Gordon, great to have you on. You need to come down and sit in the chair that Peter's sitting in one of these days.
I will do. I'll think about it.
You think about it. I've invited you before. I am now in front of the whole of Britain challenging you to come down here.
Well done, Gordon.
Hey, bless you, Gordon.
Well, maybe Peter and I can come on together and we'll really lay into them.
Okay. Don't, we don't do things like that. We love them.
Bless you.
Okay. Bless you. Be in touch,
bye.
Gordon.
Oh, thank you, Gordon. God bless.
Bye.
Fine. Kevin, sorry to keep you waiting.
No, that's fine.
Yeah, we're busy today. What can we do for you, Kevin?
Forgive me, I've got a bit of a bad cold at the moment.
No problem, take your time.
I sound a bit groggy. No, I just wanted to say, I was very interested in your last caller. I was a Jehovah's Witness from about 1971 to 1976.
Right.
And it was a very, very traumatic experience at the point just before I left. I think I was on the verge of a nervous breakdown.
Yeah, right.
I was heavily influenced by my grandfather, who was a Jehovah's Witness since about, he's no longer with us, but he was a witness since 1969. And he started talking to me about it, and I, because I'm a bit of an inquirer anyway, always have been all my life, I started the study, then I was baptized, and it got to the point where, I think that there was definitely, right from the beginning, there was something missing there.
Right.
And it all seemed to be very legalistic.
Yes. Yeah.
Although I'm not decrying the people there, they were good people.
Right, absolutely.
And loving people as well.
Yes.
But there was something missing in me that I just couldn't. And it was a constant, you went on the doors and so on. I was so up for it, as it were, on fire, if you like. They even told me that I should take things easier rather than rush in.
Very unusual.
Well, in my case they did, but I went out pioneering.
Right.
During my holidays.
Yes.
And I was cycling, up to 5 miles. And I got to the point, it may have been a bad day or whatever, or so on, people were slamming the doors in my face and all that sort of thing. But I just sort of broke down. I got back to see my grandfather, and I said, I can't do it anymore.
Right.
And I just virtually collapsed.
Yes.
And when I stopped attending the meetings, and I suppose in a way I sort of disfellowshipped myself, and but the release I found when I stopped attending, it was like a weight
off
of my shoulders.
Yes, yeah.
And I felt tremendous freedom. But the problem is, since then, I've been completely lost.
Right.
Yeah.
I wouldn't call myself a believer at all.
This is an unusual, Kevin. It's interesting that if people leave the witnesses for the reasons you did, in other words, it wasn't because somebody shared the real Christ with you, you just couldn't take the pressure anymore.
That's right.
It very often is the case. They think, well, what else is there? I haven't found anything. One of the things certainly we would encourage you to do, and I know Peter would as well, because he had that 10 years, and we're getting to share about that in just a minute after he left, is don't give up. But, okay, if that pressure was wrong, what is right? In other words, what did Jesus actually do? Did he come to give us peace, to give us rest, or did he come to pile pressure on us? And certainly what I would encourage you to do, if you can, is go onto our website. You'll find a special place where you can go through. And we would love to help you just share, no pressure, but share as we would see what Jesus can do for you today.
I mean, funny enough, I actually sort of phoned your office about half an hour ago.
Oh, right.
Because I couldn't get through at first.
All right, great.
And I'm sorry I don't know his name, but
Derek's a great guy. Yeah.
Yeah, and he actually gave me your number where you'll be tomorrow.
Fine, please give me a ring tomorrow. Love to talk to you more.
So if I could phone you, Doug.
Please do. Because we can chat through.
Yeah, I'm now 54 years of age.
Right, you're just a youngster.
And the trouble is, I've got a list of sins and misdemeanors an arm long.
You and the majority of the population.
I've been into virtually everything you can think of.
Right, yeah. Kevin. Let me just, because we've got other callers waiting. Let me get Peter just to share a bit. Because he went through something similar to what you're going through, and then we'll take up the conversation tomorrow. Okay. Peter, just share a little bit.
Kevin, my heart goes out to you, guy, because I went through exactly the same thing, virtually at the same time as you.
Yeah.
I sort of crashed and burned in the mid to late 70s.
Yeah.
And I just went through that wilderness experience, and it's just awful place to be.
Yeah.
Because you found out what isn't the truth.
That's right.
You know that, but you don't know where to find it.
No.
And the witnesses say, well, if we ain't got it, nobody's got it.
Yeah.
And that's really a problem. But Kevin, don't give up on it. I assure you.
I'm genuinely searching for the answer. I believe I found it, but I haven't yet committed myself.
You haven't got it. Kevin, give us a ring tomorrow, and we'll chat tomorrow. I look forward to that, Kevin.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Bless you.
Bless you now. Okay. Bye.
Thanks, Kevin.
Nona.
Hey.
Hello.
Mona. Hello. Can you hear me all right?
Yes, we can just about hear you. If you can speak up a little, it will be good.
Well, I've had a really bad chest.
Oh, die. Tell us about it. Carry on.
I'll try to let you. Well, the reason I'm phoning up is to give you my testimony. I was a Jehovah's Witness for 17 years.
Right.
And it is fear going on the doors.
Yeah.
But myself, I really enjoyed going round and getting the hours in, and I thought it was right until I started about 3 years before I started looking into the scriptures, and the particular scripture what used to really worry me. Mm. It was in Isaiah 10 where it says that Father, Son, and the God and Almighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And I mentioned it to one of the elders at a study, and I said, it must be Jesus, mustn't it, because it's God and Father. And he said, oh no, don't go around telling people that. And I didn't realise I was telling them fibs all the time.
Right.
And, but my family had three Christians, born again Christians, and they used to pray for me.
Great.
Christ a lot. And when my daughter came over, I told her that I'd come out of the witnesses. I was determined that God was with me all that time. I know that he was with me. And he showed me, because I used discernment from the scriptures. It was quite a lot of scriptures.
Yeah.
And Then my daughter, when I told her, she'd been on holiday with my son-in-law, and I said, oh, I've come out, and she started crying, and she came over. She said, I'm going to come and give you a hug. And she's now a vicar, my daughter.
Right.
And she's just got her home church at Treaton, and she's always praying that God looks after me. And from the beginning, I know that it was Jesus. I always
Amen.
That.
Great.
And, but the reason I did have a revelation with my other son, who was a Jehovah's Witness.
Right.
And I've got another son who was a Jehovah's Witness because my husband died and I was searching for God. And it was on the Sunday morning, but I opened the door and I was praying to God. So I felt like just committing suicide. It was terrible.
Mm.
And then the witnesses came and I started a study with them. And as the years went on, I thought it was right because they do brainwash people, you know. And they make you feel that it's really right.
Yes,
they're
right.
The ones that they think that they've got it right and no one else can. And it was lovely to know my son, because I never celebrate at Christmases,
right,
birthdays or anything.
That's right.
And I used to go to my son's and she's still a witness. And he came out, because he knew 2 years before me, David. And I went and I was fed up. I thought, well, Christmas shouldn't be like this.
Right.
And he'd told Debbie, his wife, that she was going to tell me it was Jehovah's Witnesses wrong. And anyway, I went up to bed, and then David came out of the bedroom. Debbie was crying, because she says, oh, don't tell your mum, she'll have a heart attack. and when he just got the Bible, he'd already planned it and put a marker in. In John, where the word was God. And God was the word in the beginning, was God. I never even looked at the scripture. And he says, who is it then, Mum? He says, who is it? And I says, Jesus, without looking.
Yeah.
And as soon as I said Jesus' name, I felt really marvellous.
Bless
you. All the pressure was lifted off. And it was great. And I was sat on the bed.
Yeah.
Spare bedroom, talking all night, asking him questions. And
great.
And I says, how did you know? He says, oh, well, I knew. He says, but I didn't like to tell you because I was frightened of you having a heart attack.
Ah, great. And so you've been walking with the Lord since then?
I have, yes, and it is marvellous.
Amen.
I've been in the prisons, in the hospital as sitting with people,
right,
and talking
about
Jesus. And then I hurt my leg, and then I stopped going. But then I had a dream.
Uh-huh.
And there was two doors, and this door closed, and then this other door came open.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, I've left my bedroom door open, and I realised it was a dream.
Yeah.
And it's leading me in the prisons now.
Great.
And I've been going for a year.
Bringing release to people.
And he's really using me.
Yeah. Bless you. Lovely to hear from you. Yeah, great. Thank you. The Lord continue to use you and bless you. And you pray for the witnesses that also are in prison and need releasing.
Yes, I do, yes.
Great.
Well done, Mona.
Great. Yeah, all bless you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mona.
Thank you.
Okay, bye now.
God bless, dear. Bye-bye.
Bless you. Next caller is Tommy.
Hello?
Hi, Tommy.
Hi, how are you doing?
I think I'm doing fine. How are you doodling?
I'm doing all right now.
Good on you.
Just to give a little bit of my testimony.
Great.
What it is, I used to be with the Jehovah's Witnesses for about 20 years.
Right.
And I really want to call in to explain the power of prayer, how I've come out of the JWs.
Right.
I won't go into what my life was like, what happened to me, but my life was in such a state that one day I cried out on my hands and knees to God, and I said, Jehovah, if you love me, help me in Jesus' name. And from then onwards, my wife came home one day and asked me to, she wanted me to go to the meeting. I said, I'm not going to go no more. Lord, it just like it was something holding me back, never to go over there again. I said, I'm never going to ever go over there again.
Right.
And it's a long story. I ended up in Patmos, didn't book to go there, but I said to her, I don't know where he's going to lead me or where he's going to take me. But he took me to so many places. I'm just saying, them elder Jehovah's Witnesses have been so misled, and like I was misled. And I'm not upset with them. I want to pray for them, you know?
Yeah.
But Jesus has worked in my life now and my wife's life.
Great.
You know, I just want to tell people that.
Yeah.
I was like a prisoner over there to them.
Yes.
Just man-made rules.
Yeah.
I'm not a very educated person, but, you know?
Yeah, Peter, you found, you were talking earlier on about this freedom that you found after you came out.
Yes, yeah. And indeed. And Tommy, it's just great to hear your testimony. I just want to pick up on just a little phrase you used there,
yep,
about prayer,
yeah,
and the importance of prayer. I just can't emphasize that enough, that we need to be praying for the witnesses to see the truth. And once somebody is coming, and we need to pray once they've come out to the witnesses, actually, that's not enough just to come out. Because we came out, and it would have been so much better if we'd come out and known Christ straight away.
Yeah.
But we had all that wasted time. So yeah, there's a prayer that not only would they come out to the witnesses, but they would find Christ sooner rather than later.
Yeah. But,
yeah. Great, Tommy. The Lord bless you. May He continue to use you to reach out to folks. And if you need further help, get onto our website. We'll be delighted to hear further from you.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thanks, Tommy.
Great. Okay. Bless you. Peter, I think one of the things I'd really like to get onto today is this whole area of blood transfusions, because I know it's a problem to some people. It is also very topical at the moment. In fact, just this week in Ireland, there is a court case going on because there's a Jehovah's Witness mother who's got twins, not born yet. She's 32, so weeks pregnant. But the twins are very anemic. The doctors want to give blood transfusions. She's saying no. So this is becoming a court case at the moment. We had the case very near to you, the tail end of last year, the tragedy of Emma Goff dying. And the inquest has just finished. And I found it very interesting. The coroner recorded a narrative verdict that Mrs. Goff died of severe anemia caused by complications of birth, and said that if she accepted a blood transfusion, in all probability, she would have survived. And that the midwife that was giving evidence at the inquest alluded to the fact that Mrs. Goff talked about restrictions placed upon her by her faith. Now, I don't want to start a Hate Jehovah's Witness campaign, you know that, and neither do you. But one of the things that concerns me over this is if, as on a personal basis with my family, I decided for whatever reason I didn't take blood transfusions, and my family, we agreed that together, that's one thing. What is being said here is God forbids us to take blood transfusions. And as a result, in cases like this, tragedy, a death, we don't know exactly whether it could be prevented. Quite probably it could have been prevented. And God is responsible because He said we shouldn't take blood. Now, was this an issue that caused you problems when you were in? Can you talk a little bit about to us as why Jehovah's Witnesses believe that, and the problems that you faced as a result of it?
Yeah. I think the first thing to say straight away, Doug, is that Jehovah's Witnesses take this stand not on some whim. It is a massive issue for them. They take it very seriously, and we need to understand that and to sympathise with their perspective. We may not agree with that. We're going to look at some scripture in a moment to help us to perhaps get a better perspective on it, but we must respect their commitment to do what they believe God is saying to them,
right?
Albeit maybe through the understanding, they filtered that maybe through the Watchtower's interpretation of Scripture. But maybe we could just look at the relevant passage. The one that is the key passage that the witnesses would hang this whole doctrine on is actually in Acts chapter 15.
Right.
We're going to look at the context at the moment, but we'll pick up the two verses that specifically relate to this. And in both cases, I'm going to quote from the New World Translation. It's Acts chapter 15. We'll look at the verses in isolation first, then in context, if that's okay.
Sure.
Karen. Acts 15:19, James, the spokesman for the Jerusalem Council, says this: "Hence my decision is not to trouble those from the nations who are turning to God, but to write to them to abstain from things polluted by idols, and from fornication, and from what is strangled, and from blood.
Let's just make it clear, you, at the moment, you are reading from the New World Translation, so this is what witnesses will actually read, what you are
that's
reading
right.
out now.
Yeah, that's fine. Right. And then that's linked to verse 28 and 29 of Acts 15, the same letter from James, for the Holy Spirit and we ourselves have favoured adding no further burden to you except these necessary things, to keep yourselves free from things sacrificed to idols, and from blood, and from things strangled, and from fornication. If you carefully keep yourselves from these things, you will prosper, good health to you. Now, we're not going to argue at all about the translation. No. It's fairly straightforward,
yes.
And would marry up. We would if we were reading the NIV, we would come to something
yes.
similar. I think the issue here, as with all scripture texts, we have to take it in context.
Right.
So the question that I had started to ask was this: why was that said?
Yes.
To whom was it said? By whom? And in what was the general situation? And I think the situation here was there were several problems that James was trying to address. First of all, it would appear, Doug, that certain Jewish men were insisting that Gentile believers should be circumcised. That was
right.
the main issue. In fact, they were making circumcision a salvation issue.
Yes.
In fact, other parts of the New Testament suggest that they were trying to coerce yep. new believers into old-style
yes.
Judaism. This was causing a major problem in the Christian church, because Peter and Paul had both been insisting that the only circumcision that had real value in the eyes of God was a circumcision of the heart, and that all the ceremonial parts of the Mosaic law had all really been wrapped up and fulfilled in Christ. So Peter, in this chapter of Acts, chapter 15, testifies to the great work of salvation that was being done amongst Gentile believers. Then he harks back to the Old Testament and the Mosaic law, and he says this was a yoke on the neck of the disciples which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear. In other words, the insistence on the part of some Jewish believers that Gentile believers should adhere to Jewish ceremonial law and making a precondition to salvation was actually inhibiting their growth in Christ.
Right.
So the succeeding verses all testify that God was doing this terrific work in the Gentiles. However, there was another problem that had to be addressed. Some of these new Gentile believers were acting in a way that their Jewish brethren were finding quite offensive.
So they'd all come to Christ, whether Jew or Gentile, they'd
yep.
come to Christ, but they were having problems with each other because of the background.
Yes.
Yes.
And
yes.
some of these new Gentile believers, Doug, were quite happy, for example, to buy food from the local market
right.
that had been previously offered to an idol in a temple. In fact, Paul has to deal with this in 1 Corinthians 8.
Yep.
It became a massive issue. Others, maybe, were eating meat that hadn't been bled properly. Some were eating meat from animals that had been strangled. Some commentators additionally, Doug, suggest that some of these new Gentile converts were actually going to parties held in pagan temples
right.
where there was some iffy behaviour going
yeah.
on, some immoral behaviour going on. So poor James, who has to address this issue, he's got this unenviable task of bringing harmony
yeah.
to what was potentially a divisive and explosive situation.
Yeah.
So the key verse, is verse 19.
Right.
It's my judgment, therefore, James says, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God.
Mm-hmm.
Something similar in verse 28. It seems good to the Holy Spirit and us not to burden you with anything mm-hmm. but the following requirements. He then says that it would, in his opinion, it would be helpful if these new Gentile believers abstain from meat that's been offered to idols, abstain from strangulated animals, not eating unbled meat, i.e. non-kosher meat, and avoiding these celebrations where this immoral behaviour could go on. However, Doug, I think this prohibition was neither mandatory And it can't have been mandatory because Paul in 1 Corinthians 8 says that eating food that's previously been offered to an idol in a temple is actually an issue of conscience.
Right.
Not an issue of doctrine.
Right.
And certainly not a salvation issue.
Right.
So it's neither mandatory nor do I believe it was permanent. These things were put in place, if you look at the context, to ease Jewish and Gentile relationships. And if I had to sum it up in sort of modern parlance, I think James would have been saying, if we were looking at in today's language, look, guys, can I just say this to you? We don't want to load you down with unnecessary stuff. Your salvation has got nothing to do with food, right, whether it's kosher or non-kosher. Right. It's your faith in Christ that's crucial. But to avoid giving your Jewish brothers offence unnecessarily, I would suggest for their conscience's sake, not yours, that you lay off some of these issues and these matters.
Yeah.
I think that's what it's about, Doug.
Yeah. Yeah.
If that makes sense.
It does. And it makes real sense. And of course, what is also clear from what you've said there is all that they're dealing with here in this letter in Acts 15, which of course this letter was written and then was taken and read out in various churches all the way around the area, is all to do with Old Testament sacrifices.
Yes, it
is. In other words, it's to do with, because in the Old Testament you had the sacrifice, of course, that looked forward to the one sacrifice.
Yep.
You had the blood that was shed regularly that looked forward to that blood of Jesus that was going to be shed once and for all. And it was all to do with that. It wasn't looking to do with your blood and my blood.
No.
It was looking to do with the blood of the animals that was looking forward to the blood of Jesus. And that's exactly what you've just said.
Yeah.
In other words, some of these Jewish people that had come through to Christ still wanted to hold on to those old things.
Just so.
And that was one issue. Paul deals with that. But what they were actually saying, as you said, was, look, don't force it onto the others, but hey, guys, can you meet them halfway?
That's right.
And that's really what was being said.
That's right.
So having said that, what we then come on to is the fact this has got nothing to do with blood transfusions.
It's got nothing at all to do with blood transfusions.
And so trying to use this to say to people, you must not take blood, is actually putting words in God's mouth that God has never said, which is a very serious thing.
Yes, it is. And I think for me, Doug, this is a personal tragedy. We have first-hand experience of dear friends and very close relatives who have died on this particular issue. The sadness is not just for the loss of life, as tragic as that is, but the fact that it's actually a needless sacrifice.
Yes.
It's one that God doesn't actually want us to make, doesn't ask us to make, not at all. And I think that's the tragedy. That's a great, great sadness. Heartbreaking. Heartbreaking.
And so on this side, there are two things. One, of course, what we're encouraging people to do is not to have a hateful Jehovah's Witnesses and have a hate for Jehovah's Witnesses. I know in just before Christmas, when the whole tragedy of Emma Goff came up, you get the whole thing coming out with we hate witnesses and we're encouraging people not to, because Emma and her family did it because they felt that was God's will. So on the one hand, we're encouraging people to understand. But on the other hand, we're saying that the leadership of the Watchtower organization is definitely wrong to continue to make the stand on this issue.
Yes.
Because there is no biblical reason whatsoever that people should refuse blood transfusions.
That's right. And of course, historically, it wasn't always a Jehovah's Witness position.
Right.
In the very early days of the Watchtower Society, blood transfusion was not an issue. They accepted it freely. It's only possibly the last 50 or 60 years that it became an issue. And actually now, and I think, Doug, you may correct me if that's changed, but it actually is an excommunication issue if a witness willingly takes a blood transfusion.
They've changed a bit on that recently, in this sense that, yes, it still basically is an excommunicational offence. Okay.
Right.
However, what they've said is if you're in a situation where you are forced because of the pressure to take it, you can confess afterwards and you'll be all right. Mm. So they've sort of changed, but they really in the end haven't changed, because they're still saying taking blood is going against Jehovah's will. That's what they're, in other words, they're still saying Jehovah clearly says in his word you mustn't take blood. But Jehovah doesn't say
his word.
And so although they've made this issue, and of course you had this other absolute dichotomy really of these two things, when in Bulgaria, just after communism fell, and they wanted to become a registered church. You could become a registered church, but you had to apply still to the government. And the Jehovah's Witnesses applied, and then the government said, no, you can't because of this blood issue. Mm. So they took the Bulgarian government to the Court of Human Rights, okay? And basically the Court of Human Rights bashed heads together and said, go away and sort it out. And in the end, the official documentation from the Court of Human Rights says this: the Jehovah's Witnesses said they will not preach in Bulgaria that taking blood is wrong.
Really?
Yeah. And the Bulgarian government said they would seek to give them the fact that they could take civil service instead of national service. But you see, in Bulgaria, they've compromised on an issue which everywhere else, you lay down your life. I find that to be, when I look at things like that, and I look at that, I think, what is this governing body of Jehovah's Witnesses really doing? I think if anything makes me angry, it's something like that, where you have two separate issues, where they've given it away over there, but they're still saying to people over here, you mustn't take blood.
I mean, that's just shocking, isn't it? And I don't know, I should think any witness out there that knows that will be most upset.
Well, many of them want to ignore it. I was in email correspondence with one witness, and I actually gave them the official website. So it wasn't just my documentation. Mm. It was the official website of the Court of Human Rights where this was documented. And they said, it's all been made up, because they don't want to face the issue.
No.
But they've got to face the issue at some point. There is nothing in that scripture that we have there that says God says you mustn't take blood transfusion.
No.
And we want to make that, because, it is. Have you had problems over that? Are you still having problems over that? Do give us a call, 0208 972 1408, 0208 972 1408, or email us at live@talkgod.com. These issues are so important. They are. We're not being overdramatic when we say they are issues of life and death. We have these reports here, newspaper reports that show it so. But we really do want to say to Jehovah's Witnesses, we want to say to leaders of congregation, please go back and look at the scriptures. Jehovah does not forbid taking of blood. Mm.
I was just thinking how, because it is such an emotive issue and such an emotional one, I remember when we used to go from door to door, and these occasions would come up regularly, the sort of Emma Goff situation would come up regularly, and folk, quite understandably, would get very emotional on the doors and shout and rave. And it's very easy to be tempted to do that. But all I would say is to those dear folk out there, if you come to discuss this with the witnesses, try if you can to put the emotional side on background, because it will not cut any ice with
them at
all.
That's right.
Maybe if you want to, maybe an approach might be to say, to acknowledge the sincerity of their position, because they are.
Yes.
They are sincere. Nobody would do this if they were not wholly sincere. But just to ask them gently and kindly, can we look at those passages? Would you be willing to consider, Mr. Witness, if there might be another way of looking at them. And may I share with you my understanding, the research I've done on it, what I've come up with, and maybe we can just exchange points of view on that. Would that be helpful?
Great. And of course, what we're encouraging Christians to do is to get into the Bible themselves. Yeah. In other words, if it's not saying blood transfusions, have you said what is that? You've gone back and looked at it. We've got stuff on our website and other places, of course. You can find that. And there are groups that specifically deal with this whole area of blood.
Indeed.
But Christians need to look at those scriptures themselves.
They do.
Got a caller. We'll take that now. We'll come back to that issue. Yeah. We haven't finished with it yet. David from Nottingham. Hi, David.
Hello there.
How are you doing?
I'm doing fine. How are you?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
Yeah. I'm finding this very interesting because I've phoned up in the past. I used to be a Jehovah's Witness for about 30 years.
Right.
But there were... as I started to begin to use my own reasoning, because one minute they're telling you to become a philosopher of the truth, in a sense.
Yes.
To get a personal relationship with Jehovah. And then as I started to see certain areas that, especially this one on blood, I started to see where things weren't quite right. Because up until, I mean, last year I had a triple bypass.
Right.
And out of choice, I said I don't want any blood product, but it was nothing to do with the fear of going against any doctrine.
That's right.
Like it would have been. So there's still some good things that the Jehovah's Witnesses teach about the dangers that can be involved with, you know, contaminated blood or